From the New South Network, this is the Free Lunch Podcast. This week, the spotlight is on ESPN's very own Jemele Hill. As a kid growing up in Detroit, Jemele was able to endure through substance addiction in both parents and find an outlet in sports and writing. Now, as one of the most recognizable sports journalists on the planet, she teams with co-host Michael Smith every day on the 6 p.m. Sports Center, a.k.a. The Six. In this episode, Jemele talks about how her dream to be a sports writer started with a neighbor's newspapers, why she is not afraid to clap back on social media trolls, and why she feels the Cleveland Cavaliers might already be over.
Enough talk, let's just do the ordering, okay? All right, tell you what, everything looks just fabulous. Why don't you surprise us?
Okay, Dumpling, we got three surprises coming up. Three surprises. Pick it up.
One, two, three.
Yeah, don't pull the thing.
Podcast. This is your boy Tyke BG. How you feeling?
Yeah, man. I feel great. It's another beautiful day in the neighborhood. Free Lunch Podcast. About to do it again, man. How you feel?
I feel like Jay-Z. I think I'm getting my swagger back, man. It's been a telling time over the past few weeks for your boy, man. I've been on the sick and shut-in list, as my sister would say.
You back now, and we're glad to have you back.
Yeah, I'm getting my swagger back, but I'm more excited about our guest today, and let me tell you why. You know, I've tweeted with some of the greats. I've tweeted with Mike Smith from SE6. I've tweeted with Dominique Foxworth, Richard Deitch from SportsCenter. I've only received two responses that where I fanned out.
Oh, yeah?
One of them wasn't even it wasn't a tweet, it was an email. It was with Vern Lundquist. When he responded, I kind of fanned out with Vern being an SEC guy. And the second is with today's guest.
Did you fall out like they fall out at the Michael Jackson concert?
Oh, man. I posted it on Instagram. That's how much I fanned out. And it's funny because I was like, what? And so I gave her a nickname, the Queen of the SE6, the Twitter Assassin, Team Sales Chicks on Twitter.
She don't play no game.
You remember that movie Shooter?
Yeah.
She the Bob Lee Swagger on Twitter. She just sit up high and just pick people apart. And so for me to get a response for, I felt like I was in heaven. So someone who I admire for what she does for the culture and what she brings just to journalism, with no further ado, Ms. Jemele here. How you doing?
I'm doing well, guys. What an introduction. Thank you.
Hey. You deserve it.
Yeah, you earned that.
Well, I greatly appreciate it. Very humbled by it, so thank you.
So how much fun do you take in sniping at your critic?
Well, actually, in truth, it's not. I mean, it's fun to come back at people to some degree, but the annoying part is that I have to do it at all, right? So as I often tell people is, look, for the most part, I try to stay very even-keeled and very above the fray with a lot of the nonsense that is directed my way. But sometimes you get to number 100 of the person that has come at you wrong, and then number 100, I got to make an example out of because I'm so tired of it. So,
right.
You know, I mean, it just kind of became like a sport, if you will. And I don't take pleasure in it to some degree. But it just became kind of a necessary evil after a while.
Let's talk about that. I mean, being a African-American female in sports journalism, and then essentially what you and Mike are doing with the SE6, with re-energizing and revamping that whole platform, what are some of the things you have to deal with on Twitter that we probably don't even never see?
Well, you know, it's kicked up a notch. It definitely has. since we took over.
Oh
yeah,
oh, wow.
Since we took over the 6 o'clock Sports Center. I think we both are used to, if you will, a routine level of harassment. And I know that sounds terrible because that doesn't mean I'm trying to dismiss it, but, you know, that's just the facts. So we were both, you know, kind of used to a certain level of it. And then once we took over SportsCenter because of the commercials and all the advanced campaigning, it went to a new level. And now that we're actually doing it, it went to an even higher level. So because that is combined with the fact that now it's very fashionable to act like you don't watch ESPN, even though we know that you do. And this isn't to suggest that, like, we're aware of the fact that there's been a changing model in terms of how people consume television overall that is not unique or specific to us. But this whole, like, oh, I don't watch ESPN anymore, and, you know, ESPN is too liberal, that whole movement. So we got swept up in that. And as a result, we've had to deal with a level of backlash that while we anticipated it would be there, we just never thought it would be to some degree at this level.
A thing that I've been kind of questioning is this connection from what we're seeing with, like, politics and some of the things that's happening within some of the major networks. Do you see what's going on socially, politically, affecting what's happening within the network?
Anecdotally, I can definitely tell you that it seems to be a correlation. And just keeping it all the way real, I think because of the boldness that some folks in our government have mm-hmm. expressed in voicing certain opinions and being as brash and bold as they are, it has emboldened a level of stupid in our country that now the folks that used to stay quiet because they felt ashamed of what they wanted, of the things they thought in their mind, now those same people are, like, saying it out loud and feeling like that they have some kind of entitlement to a voice. And, yes, we do all work under the guise of free speech. But as I like to say, before I further say this, can I cuss on this podcast or no?
Like, go for it. You got to live up to it, Jay.
I got to?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes,
so,
absolutely.
I know my co-host who you had on before likes to curse, but as often, I wear a t-shirt in public. I've worn it a few times, and I feel this way. I said, don't let your president get your ass whooped. And it's the truth, because there's a lot of people out here who are emboldened by what they see as somebody being, quote, not politically correct. I'm like, you could do that, and you could not be politically correct, and you could say whatever you want to say, and God bless America, but God bless these hands, because you will catch some out in real life.
Yeah,
yeah,
there are consequences.
Absolutely. With the numbers and the direction that ESPN has taken, just all of their platforms, and really relying heavily on talent, how do you and Mike get evaluated with there being so many multiple ways to consume your show and other shows?
So a lot of people want to be TV experts now and
right.
act like they understand what's happening. So to give you a
mm-hmm.
breakdown, and I'm glad you really asked that question, what people don't understand is that so some of the losses that have occurred in television in general that are not unique to ESPN is based off the fact that people are heavily into streaming services, into
mm-hmm.
those, really, you know, Netflix, Hulu, like everybody, they're doing different things in how they do TV. And we have a generation of consumers that are getting very accustomed to watching television unrelated to cable. There it
mm-hmm.
is, right? So we all know this. Again, not a problem unique to ESPN. We just happen to be the ones that are the biggest target because of what it generally costs to subscribe to ESPN. So it's unrelated to any of these other emotional things that people keep pointing out. So for most of us, how we get evaluated, numbers are a part of it. Yes, ratings are always going to be a part of our business and how you're evaluated. The other part that you will be evaluated with is who you can bring to the table. And It's been kind of funny to me that people have had all these armchair opinions about what Mike and I aren't bringing to the table and not realizing what we are. Because, as I often like to point out, is that Phil's silly little things that run in between our show, they're called, in between the breaks, they're called commercials. Okay? And when we have, and if they notice in watching our show, there's so many elements of our show that are sponsored, that advertisers want to work with us because of who we're bringing to the table. Like, all of a sudden, you see State Farm. State Farm wanted to work with us, okay? Apple Music developed a playlist for us. Like, all
which
these
is
people.
Dope, that's, which is very dope.
Yo, thank you. I appreciate it. That's called money we're bringing to the table, all right? So, and part of the reason we're bringing that money to the table is because one of the trends that has happened just in us taking over the show is that the average age of the person watching SportsCenter now has dropped about 10 to 12 years, which is kind of unheard of in a couple months. So that's dropped. And I know this will not be a shock to you guys, but the number of African Americans now watching the 6 o'clock SportsCenter has risen considerably. So it's gotten blacker and younger. It's like we're real fast, right? Those are actually, and this is no surprise, but that's a base that a lot of companies want to work with. Younger, blacker. That's how it works. So we're bringing, there was already a party. We're bringing different people to the party. And so in doing that, that's how we justify our salaries. That's part of how we're evaluating. It's who are you bringing to this party? So, you know, it's not just about ratings because, as you pointed out, it isn't just us. And I don't say this because it's not a great show, but, like, PTI is down, too. They're not doing fake pieces on PTI, right?
Right.
Or some of the other shows on our network. Because it's a groundbreaking show. It is the foundational show for opinion and commentary on our network. But they're made men. And there's a lot more scrutiny on what we're doing as opposed to what they're doing.
And, man, we've had Mike on a couple of times. He's given us his perspective on what the six means to him. Like, what level of meaning do you feel that it has on where we are now, culturally, socially, all the above?
Well, I mean, it means a lot because of the people. I mean, it means a lot because it's ESPN. It means a lot because 6 o'clock, is like the evening news of sports television, right? But it also means a lot because of who has been a 6 o'clock SportsCenter anchor. You're talking about Stuart Scott and Mike Greenberg and all these, you know, Hall of Fame level broadcasters, and now we're sitting in those seats. So for us, despite the enormous challenges that do come with being at 6 o'clock, I mean, it's been a thrill, you know, to be falling in line with all of those names. So, you know, for me, the word, when I think about what the 6 o'clock SportsCenter means, to me it means legacy. So, yeah, we're just trying to uphold it, to be honest.
Oh, something that I've been intrigued by just at ESPN and what I've heard a lot of, I'm a supporter and listener of obviously your show. And I've also listened to the Dan Le Batard show a lot. I like that show a lot as well. And I hear this whole idea about creative freedom. From your perspective, how important is that creative freedom to do your show and some of the things that y'all have done brought to the table with the parodies, et cetera?
I mean, it's critical. And what people may not also understand about us doing this is we didn't seek this opportunity out. They came to us. We were not, for both of us, the idea of hosting the 6 o'clock Sports Center or any Sports Center, frankly, was never on our, as they like to call it, it was never on our vision board, ever. But part of the reason they did come to us is because of what we did on His and Hers, and they enjoyed how fluid the show was, obviously our chemistry, our relationship, and how we, you know, kind of constructed the show. A lot of what goes into that is creative freedom. And I cracked up because when we first jumped over to the 6 o'clock spot, so many of the people who watch us on His and Hers, they were so deathly afraid that we would be different. And I'm thinking, you do realize that even on ESPN2, we're all drawing a paycheck from the same place. It's not like it's some secret network that the executives don't know about. So trust me, if it was something they didn't like or didn't want us to do anymore, they would have changed it then. So moving over and to expand over on your question, it's like the creative freedom is crucial, and because it's an extension of who we are. I mean, yes, we're still, the SC6 is still very much in its infancy. We're still trying new things, figuring out what works, figuring out what doesn't work. Same process we went through His and Hers. It's just that there's way more people paying attention to it now. The thing is that, you know, everything, the content begins and ends with us. There's nothing in the show we don't want to be in the show. And we are fortunate that ESPN has given us, or has instilled, rather, that level of trust in us. And they are okay, you know, with the editorial decisions that we make. Now, much like it would be for anybody's show, and this applies to Leverage Art as well, who I think has one of the most, you know, in terms of creative freedom, I mean, he has a show that's right up there on the network that's having the most. One of the things that definitely happens is, obviously, you run into situations where you may see things one way, they see things another way, and you try to meet in the middle. And that's, again, routine for every show. But by and large, I mean, we have pretty much complete creative freedom over our show.
Are there some new things that we haven't seen that are in the works? So, for example, I am absolutely loving the parodies you all did with the theme song. have y'all thought about doing a Martin or a Brady Bunch, or what y'all got in the works?
Well, we I'll just say this, and I'm not going to be specific about which ones, but we knew we wanted to recreate about 10 different sitcom openings. So far, we've done two, and that's all I'll say. I won't tell you what the other ones are. Because we have others that we want to do. We're really hoping we get an opportunity to shoot one this summer. And that's the other thing. It's like these, they take time, and they take a lot of planning. And to give an example, like the Different World one was the last one we did, and that took 6 hours to do.
And, oh, wow.
Yeah, no, they take time because we want to do it perfect, right, basically, and it's shot by shot. And we raised it to another level because we actually, when we got original members from the cast to be in it. So now we've set that bar. We got to kind of keep going and feel now even more obligated to, if we do more of these, to get people from the original cast of what we're trying to reproduce in it. And as you know, it is not easy to get actual people who are trained actors in these things. So it just takes a lot of coordination. This is my long-winded way of saying that. And we have some things in the works. All I can tell you is that the couple ones you suggested, they come up, and I'll leave it at that.
Okay. Hey, BG, I'm telling you, BG, now I would love to see, even if they did a segment, if we saw a Martin segment or something, that would be dope. Because Martin, Fresh Prince of Bel-Air, Brady Bunch, we all grew up in that era.
Right.
Are you trying to ease your way into the creative thing?
No. I mean, well, if they got to open it, I'll work for free.
That's good to know. Thank you. Good to know.
How did you find journalism?
Who is Mr. Miller?
Was it
Mr. Miller? I think that's his name.
Yeah, it was Mr. Miller. Look at you doing your research.
Absolutely.
So my, you know, my origin story, as they call it, was simply this. I mean, I don't ever remember when sports was not a part of my life. And I loved it from the beginning. So I never went through some period where I had to be convinced to like sports or anything like that. Like, I always love sports. But back in the good old days, before the internet, the only way that you could really keep up with your teams or your sports that you liked was to read the newspaper. And my mother, I grew up on welfare, and my mother on the side would clean houses. And so there was a gentleman named Mr. Miller that she would clean his house once a week or once every couple of weeks, and I would go with her, and he subscribed to the newspaper, or both newspapers, because I'm from Detroit, and it's a two-newspaper town. You have the Detroit News and the Detroit Free Press. And so because we didn't have a newspaper subscription, whenever I would go with her, I would read his newspapers. And so I would just read them and read the sports section in particular. And I think he just kind of noticed that I had this interest, and I was a big Tigers fan. He was a big Tigers fan. So pretty soon, you know, he and I would be watching games, and I'd be reading the newspaper and all this kind of stuff. So my consumption habit led to a curiosity where I wanted to know how could you write about sports. Because I grew up reading, Mitch Albom and all these other, Terry Foster, all these Detroit columnists, Brian Burwell. And I think it was in high school, when I could take a high school journalism class, I did it. And it was sort of love at first sight. Like, I never wanted to do anything else. This was the only thing I've ever wanted to do. And yeah, the rest is kind of history. I wrote for my high school newspaper. I wrote for my college newspaper. I had a bunch of different internships. Before I got to ESPN, I worked at, you know, multiple newspapers. I was a sports columnist. I did all these things because this is the only thing I've ever wanted to do. So as I often tell people, I was one of those really fortunate people who knew early. And because I knew early, I was able to sort of program and direct my professional career around that.
And I think that's a key, just being able to understand what you're passionate about. The earlier you learn, the sooner you can kind of follow that path. But there's a piece you left out of that story that I think is very intriguing, just about you. You mentioned you grew up on welfare, but I know you grew up, your parents were both on drugs. Now they've recovered from that. But can you just talk about what that was like?
Yeah, I've spoken very openly about this. So it's definitely not something I'm ashamed of, and something I felt like has helped me be who I am. You know, my father, he had a heroin addiction. My mother, she was addicted to prescription drugs and had tried a lot of different drugs that she will tell me herself. And so growing up that way, obviously when you're going through it, there's a certain level of dysfunctional normalcy that kind of settles in with it. And starting with my father, you know, he and I were estranged for quite a bit because as he tried to battle through his drug problem, and my mother, understandably so, she often tells me the story about, like, how she knew she had to kind of leave him alone and basically let him work out his own issue, is that, you know, he was holding me in his arms. He was holding me with one arm. He had a needle stuck in his arm with the other. And when she saw that, and he was, like, literally nodding, and addicts know what nodding is. And so my mother was just like, yo, this cannot be the situation that I have you in. And so, you know, she kind of created some understandable distance between the two of us as he figured out his problem. But unfortunately, in the process, she developed her own problem. So growing up, that old adage about it taking a village is really very true. And despite her struggles that she was going through, both with poverty, drugs, is that I had people, thankfully, in my life that kind of stepped in different key moments that allowed me to continue to understand that I had a purpose. And even on some of her worst days, my mother would often preach that to me as well. And you know how it is with parents. They are the masters of do what I say, not what I do. And my mother was that way. whereas mm-hmm. even in her worst moments, she would be like, do not be or do anything like I did it. And so, mm-hmm. like, that's why she was really hard on me about education and about making it out, because she didn't want me to become a reflection of the bad choices that she made. I had a very strong grandmother who, when needed, would, you know, come and rescue me on occasions from certain things, and I spent a lot of time with her, and we were very close. And just other, you know, people, other friends or family and that kind of thing. So, you know, life was, at the time, there was a certain difficulty that I knew I was going through, but I didn't really know how to articulate it, or I didn't understand it. But there was certainly a sense for me of knowing that I was not experiencing a normal childhood in the slightest. And certainly when you grow up poor, there's a lot of things that you feel like you're missing out on. And so my entire goal setting was all about doing everything I needed to do to get out of these circumstances that I was in. And the good thing about it was that, or I should say among the good things about it, it wasn't just one thing, was that, yeah, it did allow me to develop a tough skin. And it is what allows me now to not take this TV shit so serious, because I've seen a whole lot worse. My worst day on television will never match the worst day I experienced as a child, ever. Mm. Never will happen.
How old are you? How old are you during this period? For me to...
I mean, honestly, let's see. I moved out the house when I left for college. I was 17 years old.
Mm-hmm.
My father, he got clean before my mother did. And so by that time when I left, he and I were sort of beginning to have a better relationship. He and I probably started our relationship when I was, I don't know, maybe like 10 or 11. And, you know, it was a process. It took some time. The entire time that I would say probably, I'm going to say from 7 or 8 years old until I left the house, my mother struggled with drugs, and we were poor pretty much the entire time. So that was the definitive fabric of my childhood. And, you know, she didn't truly, truly get clean until after I left the house. So the reality is, and this is why probably one of the many things that bothered me greatly about the conversations we have in our country is about, you know, people, is about poor people. Because people have this, especially now, and again, especially under the current language of government, people act like being poor is a moral choice. Like, I just grew up and asked to be it. Like, you know what I want to do, God? I want to be poor as fuck when I'm growing up. No, nobody asked to do that.
No one asked to do that.
Right. I mean, they don't. And we treat poor people and people who are in inner cities or even rural communities, they get a different stereotype, but I'm going to just stick it to being black and poor for right now, is that we treat that like that's some kind of moral failure. I did not ask to be born in the circumstances I was born into. And a lot of the decisions and choices that my mother unfortunately made, they were not based off her inability to be a moral person. They were based off survival, which is completely different. So I say all that to say, and to come down off the soapbox, is like, it was a lot of rough days, you know, that I had growing up. And even my mother and I were talking about this not too long ago, because I've told her repeatedly, as she's lived a different kind of life for the last probably 20 years, is that she needs to stop apologizing to me for things that happened, you know, so long ago. Because as I told her, although I would not wish that necessarily on anybody else, if that was the engine that helped me get to this point, I'm glad I went through it. I'm glad I endured it. And we were, you know, kind of talking like about how one time, one of the most hurtful things she probably did to me growing up was she stole money from me. And she actually sold a television that I really liked, because she was on drugs. Right. And so, it was very hurtful to experience that as a child because it's a thing you're attached to and it's a material possession. But how I look at that then versus now is completely different, that I realized it was just a function of the fact that she was living with a disease and didn't know any better. And that's not to absolve her from anything, but it's just, it kind of is what it is. And so I say all that to say is that when I'm going through these moments of either career insecurity or things aren't, I have a show, I don't necessarily, you know, didn't feel like I performed my best or something bad happens, I'm able to reflect back on that moment and be like, you know, I was once the kid whose mama stole from him and sold my TV. So whatever I'm experiencing now, as long as I see it through that perspective, I'm good.
I think that makes it clear why what you do every day is more than just the sports that you're reporting on. It's about all of these things that compose what life is.
Yeah, it is why I'm you know, so passionate about certain things, and why I'm too stubborn to be quiet about certain things too. And I don't, again, I don't believe in regrets. I believe in the fact that there's a lot of things we all experience that make you who you are. And so that's why I say it's, you know, kind of painful as some of those experiences were then. I'm very happy that I went through them because I don't know if I would be the person that I am today without them.
I'm very intrigued at life, and I'm very intrigued at how we never, if we follow our passion or our heart, it'll take us to a place that we probably never envisioned or dreamed. But if you were asked the question back then, I want to be this when I grow up, what would that have been?
I think I would have just said a writer in general.
A writer.
Because mm-hmm. I've always written. I had journals growing up, I had diaries. I used to write short stories. I used to write little mini novels. You know, I was a real writing nerd. And so much so, because I think coinciding with being a writing nerd means also you read a lot. And I used to have a library card and go to the library. And so my head was always in a book, you know. So I think that was, and that remains a big part of who I am. I love to absorb knowledge. And I tell younger journalists this because I firmly believe it. If you are curious, you're never going to be a good journalist. Like if you don't have an innate curiosity about how things work, why they work the way they do, or you don't want to ask questions, you're not going to be good at this. And that has always been a big part and a big piece of who I am. It's like I want to know more. I want to know the most that I can know about things because I want to know how we got here and why this works this way. And I need to know how the engine runs. Even if I can't necessarily put it together myself, but I want to know how it runs. And so for me, like that is, I was always that way as a kid. I wasn't necessarily nosy, even though I do believe that's also a part of being a journalist, but I always wanted to know why. And so I think had you talked to me at that point, you know, I probably would have been the annoying kid, like, well, why? Why does it do that? And why does it do that? And why does it do that? That was me. So that's something I've sort of carried with me, obviously, throughout my career, and it's been a big piece of me being where I am.
Another question just around childhood is, so I know you ran option in the street playing football. We know that. We know you,
man,
were a tomboy. We know you were a tomboy growing up.
I hate Notre Dame. I mean, going to Michigan State, that's just, and growing up in Michigan, period, that's just part of your life, right? You just hate Notre Dame. But
right.
Man, Tony Rice on that option, you ain't want to see me. I was remember that. You didn't want to see me.
No, not Tony Rice.
Oh, yes, I'm that old. Like, I remember when Tony Rice was doing it, and it was like, to emulate doing the options, like our football field was about five houses, right? And so the five lawns, let me tell you, I was out there like, look, we about to do this, all right? And we didn't have any no-tackle rules. And so I always had a strong arm. So I was out there flinging that thing. Back in my day, I thought I was Michael Vick. Like, I ain't seen a lot before Michael Vick. Like, that's when I had wheels.
So you weren't pitching, you were keeping.
Oh, I was totally keeping. I learned to pitch too. And look, I'm not going to lie. I laid out many a neighborhood wide receiver over somebody's Cadillac. Like, all the time with my errant throws. They say I was the most accurate. I had a laser. Wasn't real accurate. And so sometimes I was like, ooh. You know, I didn't mean for that windshield to quite wind up or that way.
Hilarious.
We got it done. Those are fun times.
But the question is this. You were a bookworm. You read a lot. You journaled a lot. But then you also played street football with the guys. What would your peers say about this Jemele at that time? Were you the nerd? Were you the tomboy that was doing backflip flips off the mattresses?
Off the garage. That's how we did it.
How would they describe that, girl?
Obviously, one of the compliments I kind of hear on a routine basis from both men and women alike, and even mentioned this in the intro when former First Lady Michelle Obama complimented me for knowing how to hold my own against dudes. And part of the reason I'm able to do that is because of my background in sports. And you guys know that even though guys may give you a hard time about certain things, the fact of the matter is, if you could play, you could play. And I was a natural athlete. Not to brag on myself, but I guess I am going to brag on myself, is that, like, I mean, I really had a spectacular arm. Feel like I still do. I haven't been out there in a while. I mean, it's the reason why I played shortstop in high school. It's like I had a spectacular arm, and there were certain things athletically that I could do that garnered the respect of the guys in the neighborhood. And so, yeah, I was a nerd. And, yeah, I did, you know, I read and did those other things. But what gave me a cool chick factor was the fact I could play sports. So even if dudes wanted to come at me and try to challenge me on some level athletically because I could hold my own, that conversation was shut down. Like, they would say they're, oh, such and such, she throw like a girl, blah, blah, blah. The person they never were going to say that about me was me. And so I was that chick that when we were all in the neighborhood picking teams, everybody wanted to have me. And so because of that, that allowed me a level of acceptance with dudes that got me real comfortable early in the sense that, like, I wasn't afraid to voice my opinion to them. And because I watched sports, too. So I was watching the same things they were watching, could play how they could play. And so it automatically led to this kinship. And so I was the homie. And, yeah, I mean, guys, even at that age and even in some degree now, people to some degree outside looking in kind of marvel at the fact that I have a lot of really good, close male friendships, platonic, I must say. I have a lot of those. Like, even with Mike and I in our relationship, people are shocked by it. Like, they don't even understand it because they're like, how are y'all on TV every day and how are y'all still that close and this and that and I don't get it and blah, 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 blah. And I'm like, well, because you probably don't get me and this is how I've always been growing up. And so, yeah, for me, it's like if, you know, people who know me now could look in on those times, they would not be shocked. They would not be surprised at all because I'm still that way. I mean, me and my boyfriend had these competitions because he was another one that tried to try me. And I was just like, I told you.
Ooh, old dude, old dude. Is that his name? Old boy.
We have these, I would call them athletic dates, if you will. So I was visiting him. And we went to the batting cage, and I had a feeling that he didn't know how I used to get down. And I was just like, look, I'm telling you, when I was out there playing softball, like, I was really, really good. So we go to the batting cage, and I had to show off on him. And I was like, you know, I was out there looking like a young A-Rod, you know what I'm saying? Like, I'm telling you, I used to do this thing, all right? So at any rate, and as you know, when you hang around dudes and, because you guys are dudes, so you understand this even more so. Like, being around men, developing that early sense of confidence that sports gave me, hence why I'm such a proponent of women playing sports, and I know what it does for your self-esteem, for your body image, all those things. It gave me that layer of confidence. So when I was in the company of men, I never thought that I should be shyer or I should be a different person because these are guys that I'm afraid of the way they look at me. And getting back to how we started this conversation about how I roast people on Twitter. You know how I can roast people on Twitter and they're getting the real PG version is because of how, as you guys know, you would roast each other in the neighborhood. Like, I've been on that before. Well, we've been going at each other's mamas and we've been going at each other's family situations. And we've been talking about such and such wearing the same jeans for 3 days. Like, I've been in those situations so many times that the people that come at me on Twitter, I was like, y'all lucky I got a job because you don't realize how badly I could roast you. I'm taking it easy. I'm being polite to you.
Absolutely.
I can end your life with some things I can say, right? So that's how I developed kind of a laser-like tongue and the ability to come back because I've been there. And besides that, I mean, when you have a Jerry girl, yo, you're going to experience some things. And I had one, and the reality is, not only have a Jerry girl, but have a Jerry girl a year too late, yo, you're going to catch hell. Right, so there's nothing that they can say to me that was worse than all the roasting I got in ninth grade. That's all I can say.
We talk about that too, BG. We talk about sitting on the back of the bus when we was growing up and having to be sharp on your feet with that whip because you were janking. Y'all get into janking matches and see who can out jank who.
Especially on the bus, like you. Oh. Were, I mean, I caught the city bus. Basically on the high school or whatever, and you ain't never lied. Waiting at the bus stop, being on the back of the bus, you had to be made of some strong stuff to take that.
You had to. You got to be able to jank because they finna jank you. That's
right.
Fast forward.
Exactly.
You got to. You taking me back because that's exactly what we did growing up in high school. From your eyes, what would you consider to be your greatest pieces of work?
That's such a tough question, only because I think as you're in it, like you never stop to think like, oh man, this is definitive. This is legacy building or something like that. So when you ask an athlete, like when somebody like LeBron and or other players, when they're asked about things they achieve and they literally have no answers because they're too in the moment, they're too doing it, and they can't really step back to see. So it's hard for me, but I mean, I can. I can certainly recall some of my, favorite pieces that I've done, a couple of which I've won awards for. Most of my favorite pieces I've ever done have never been on athletes that everybody knows, And it was funny because last night I went to dinner with Wright Thompson, who is one of the greatest writers of our generation as a sports writer. He's tremendous. And to me, he wrote probably the definitive piece on Michael Jordan, and that's so hard to do. Like, people who have talked, and we've been in the spotlight for years and years and years, and to find out new things and new vulnerabilities about them, that's so incredibly difficult. And I don't think I've ever written anything that good. But in terms of favorite pieces, I remember when I lived in Raleigh and I was working for the News and Observer, I wrote a piece about the Citadel's first female athlete. And that still remains one of my favorite pieces because of all the things I learned in doing it. I'd never been to the Citadel. I didn't understand military culture. And it was on the heels of when the Citadel was really starting, when they were first starting to incubate women into the academy. And so there was a lot of national conversation about where the women belong there and all these other things. And so to go down there, do a piece on her, it was a lot of fun, and it came together. And I got to, witness her as she went through, as they call it, knob training, which is kind of a glossed up way of hazing, but it wasn't hazing in the sense that anything bad was happening to her, but she had to do all these things in order to prove herself to be a part of the culture, and I got to witness pretty much all of it. And so So that remained certainly one of my favorite pieces. And even once I got to ESPN, I think doing some of the outside the line pieces that I've done, that's been very gratifying because those are those pieces are very hard to do. I mean, they take years off your life. You feel like, you know, you gotta spend usually 3 to 5 months doing them. I mean, so they're not easy. You spend 3 to 5 months investing and doing them, and the on-air piece will probably tally to about 6 minutes if you're lucky. And those have been very, very difficult to do. And so I've developed a sense of gratification by just even achieving it, if you will. So, I couldn't even begin to tell you what I thought was the best show I ever did. I don't even know. It's like, honestly, I don't know. I mean, every day feels so different, and it kind of is what it is. But, like, I'm just really, for me, it's not about, I mean, being great every single day is a piece of this, but it's more about having the level of consistency. If I can be consistently good, then I'm fine. Like, I don't need to have some viral moment or whatever. I just want to be consistently intelligent on a daily basis. That's pretty much all I strive for.
2008, you got suspended for a piece you wrote, NBA Finals, Celtics, Pistons. Just so our audience is familiar with the story, can you give us some background about that particular piece and what you went through and how you grew out of that incident?
It's definitely the most embarrassing moment of my professional career. And, you know, essentially what happened is I got too cute. And it was a great lesson to learn.
And this is actually a question I had about that too, Jemele.
It was edited, and no, I did not post my own story, but the reality is, like, I'm still, in my mind, I still feel like 100% of the responsibility bears on me, even though, yes, you're right, technically the way this thing works is editors are supposed to save you from yourself. And I get that. But I would never blame an editor. And the editor who did run it was reprimanded. Like, I would never blame an editor for what happened only because I wrote it. In my mind, in my thought process, I thought that was acceptable. And so, to make a long story short, is that essentially I made a very inappropriate comparison of Boston Celtics fans, because at the time, what was happening, it was an off-day column, too, a game column. And when I said I got too cute, by that I meant, to me, the entire breakdown in the situation more or less got back to the why. It was an off-day column. I hadn't given enough thought to what the idea was going to be. And it was during the Celtics-Lakers series when the Celtics beat the Lakers when Pierce and all those guys came together. So I did not think about the idea enough. I went with a lazy idea, and that to me is why I consider it to be so embarrassing. I mean, of course, it's about what I eventually wrote, but to me, the real problematic thing about how that column even came into fruition was based on the fact that I didn't have anything better to write. And so I essentially was marveling, and I've been kicking this process around in my mind throughout the series, is where I grew up in Detroit, the Celtics were very hated. Everybody hated the Celtics, and they're not just unique to Detroit, but, like, they obviously, given the history, really hated the Celtics. Right. And because of Pierce, Garnett, Ray Allen, suddenly you had people who were actually weirdly rooting for them. And it tripped me out that, like, a lot of my friends wanted the Celtics to win that series, because I'm like, y'all actually are rooting for the Celtics. We used to hate the Celtics. So the premise of the column was that. And then I made a bunch of probably not funny, lazy comparisons, like, oh, if you root for the Celtics and you're from Detroit. I think one of the lines, the line that never gets talked about, which in hindsight is probably in the field of being really inappropriate, is that I said it's like rooting for R. Kelly. That line never gets discussed, and that's probably worse. That's probably as bad, right? Especially considering how that turned out, I was like, ooh, that's probably really bad. At any rate, I made an inappropriate comparison and said, you know, if you root for the Celtics, that's like rooting for Hitler. And it got me suspended, deservedly so. The joke, though, that we do have around ESPN is like, you're not somebody until you spend some time in the penalty box, until you do a bid, as I call it. Right. Uh-huh. Until you do a bid, you ain't nobody at ESPN. Right. So I did a week-long bid. But as I like to point out, with pay, and all the apologies, everything I wrote was because I felt that way, and people have often, even at the time, they, you know, often said like, well, they just made you apologize. No, they didn't make me apologize. It's like I apologized because I was wrong, and so one of the silver linings that kind of came out of that, in addition to it being a real wake-up call for me as a professional, is when you go through something like that, you know who your real friends are in this business. And a lot of people, so many people that I respect and love in this business and continue to be very close with, reached out to me, so many of them. And they were just like, look, you'll get through this. Very supportive and encouraging. And probably, I'll never forget this. Dan Wetzel, who is a phenomenal writer. I've been friends with him for many years. I will never forget the email he sent me after all this was blowing up. And he's like, next time, Stalin. Compare him to Stalin. No one ever gets upset about Stalin. Joseph Stalin. Obviously tongue-in-cheek. And I was just like, you're right, you know. So, at any rate, it taught me a lot personally, you know, professionally. And, look, I'm thankful on a lot of levels it happened then, because if that happens now, I don't know if I still have a job.
I don't know if we got into this, but following around the NBA, what have been some of your takeaways from what has transpired, KD's performances, thoughts?
Well, this just in. The Warriors are really good. But, well, I mean, there's been a lot of takeaways on a professional level. I'll say that for Kevin Durant, I'm happy for him because on a macro level, and I've said this consistently, as he has decided from the time he made the decision to go to Golden State, is people don't see it this way, but I think what he did was very bold. It was bold in the respect of, you know how bold you got to be to leave a team that you were, you know, leave a team like Oklahoma City, in which you were up on the team you joined, and go there and make it was a courageous, bold step, because no one ever does that. No one ever says, like, I'm going to join this team that I almost just beat in the finals, and for the reasons he did it. Because I think from a basketball standpoint, it really suited him. And I don't say that to try to take an undercover shot at Russell Westbrook, but we all know he plays a certain kind of way. And I never thought, and Mike always, he and I have argued about this for literally, I feel like 5 years.
And I was about to argue with you too, because bold, yes, courageous, absolutely not.
The reason why it's courageous is because no one does it. Like, no one does this, right? And I think it takes a lot of courage to not only join a team that, again, you all almost beat, but to change your situation. You know, the easy thing for players is to stay in the situation. No disrespect, but look at Melo. He's doing literally the easiest thing you could possibly do, which is stay with the Knicks. That's easy, okay? No, but it is. Keep collecting a check. Keep getting paid the max. That is what players do, and it's no disrespect to them, but they do it all the time. What people never do is what he did and what LeBron did, like to literally say, I'm going to piss off the entire country by going to Golden State. I'm going to piss off the world, if you're LeBron James, by going to Miami. Like, no one does that, okay? And so I think there's a certain courageousness and boldness in that, especially when you're young. And they did what I often encourage young people to do. While you're young, take a risk. Take a risk while you can, because you're going to get to a point in your life where you're going to want to do that thing. And you're going to look back in this and say, why did I try this? Why did I do this? Why didn't I see how this would turn out? And that's why I use the term courageous, even though I know you're thinking there's no courage in joining a 73-win team. I get it. But the whole point is that you're actually putting more pressure on yourself. Because if you get there and they don't get back and they don't, you know, have some level of equal success, everybody's blaming you. Everybody's clowning you. The easy thing would have been to go back to Oklahoma City and try it again. That would have been the easy thing.
But they were so close.
That would have been the expected thing to do. Expected. And I get it. Like, yo, we all have been on those teams. Like, you play a pickup ball, a team beats you. Run it back. That's all our mentality. I get it.
Absolutely.
But, and I know that competitively, it is very appalling to people. Because you're thinking, like, why are you going to join the team that you almost beat? Understand that. But putting all that aside, I think from a basketball culture standpoint, Golden State really fit him. Had they not had those 73 wins and, you know, been down 3-1 and all that, then it's kind of like, all right, well, he's just joining another team. But because they had accomplished what they had, we just look at it more disdainfully. Now, look, at the time they didn't know this, but truth of the matter is that 3-1, all that clowning this year, getting Kevin Durant, it was worth it. It happened for a reason. It was totally worth it. If you get him and you wind up winning championships for the next 5 years. So that's one answer to your question. Is like, it's been good to see Kevin Durant be on the stage again, be the player we all knew he was, and just really kind of the level of comfort I think that he has now is a level I've never seen him with in his whole career.
Yeah.
The other thing for me is to also see Steph Curry go through this. Kevin Durant has been the headline, but the person whose reputation I think took a hit after last year and really how he played the last two finals was Steph Curry. And he is, you know, we're seeing a different level of killer instinct in him now. And if not for Kevin Durant, you know, the crazy stat to me is when you look at Steph's numbers, and he also is almost averaging a triple-double in the series. So you have that part. You obviously have, you know, LeBron, who is averaging a triple-double, and he's been fantastic. But it's been a long time since we've seen LeBron in a pretty much a helpless situation. I haven't seen him in a situation this helpless until the last time I covered a finals in Cleveland, which was when he went against San Antonio early in his career, and they got mollywopped. He was putting up great numbers in that series. He was not the player that he is now. And
absolutely
that,
not. Mm-hmm.
You know, San Antonio's entire, like, it's just so funny to see people evolve. San Antonio's entire strategy that series was they just basically left him completely unchecked anytime he took a jump shot. Completely unchecked. They were just like, we'll take our chances with you shooting that 15-footer. Mm-hmm. And he wouldn't even take in threes then. So to see, you know, him evolve into the player he is now is, like, really spectacular. But, yeah, I mean, that's the last time LeBron has been that overmatched. And so we're seeing him overmatched in a way we haven't seen him overmatched in a long time. And the ramification, it's going to force Cleveland this summer to blow this team up. It's going to force them to do it if they want to keep LeBron. And people forget he's only got a year left on the deal with Cleveland because he always wanted to put the pressure on them to keep competing for titles.
Right.
And you get waxed by Golden State, and Kevin Durant has already put it out there. He'll take less money to stay. Steph is going to get that $200 million, and the core of this team is going to be together for at least 4 years. Another 4 years? Got to blow it up.
Let me ask you this, though. Do you think, this was just a hypothetical question I asked a friend of mine. If they bring a Melo in and say, D-Wade owes LeBron a favor, and he does a one-year. Say Melo, D-Wade do a one-year deal, join the Cavs. You get rid of some of the guys that are on the bench, but you keep Kyrie, and you find a way to keep Love. Can that team assembled for 1 year beat this Golden State team?
So D-Wade could do that because he can do it. A player opt-out. He can opt out of his
player
contract
opt-out.
Right now.
Yeah, just 1 year.
Right? He can do that. So that's possible. Problem is Melo. They're not going to just let him leave. And the reason why I say they have to blow it up is because the Cavs don't have any draft picks. All right? They mortgaged them all. for the most part, right, to get the team that they have now. So the only thing they have of currency is Kyrie or Kevin Love. And if you're in New York, you have no incentive to give Cleveland anything on the cheap. For what? Like, for mm-hmm. what? And so they could never keep all those players together. They're going to have to sacrifice somebody. And I know Melo's name is brought up a lot. I don't think Melo makes them good enough to beat Golden State because of the type of player that he is and what Golden State has become. Melo is not a fast player. He is a ball stopper, half-court offense player. That's not Golden State, right? Golden State, mm-hmm. it will run Melo into the ground. So I'm like, it makes them different, right? It doesn't make them better.
I don't have the answer, but I know LeBron and his team what is it, Rich Paul and Maverick, they they'll go back to the drawing board and they'll figure it out. They will,
but unfortunately, the only two scenarios that to me can get LeBron to getting back to opening his championship windows are two scenarios that seem completely ridiculous, but true. One is he has to leave. And I mean, honestly, like LeBron, he can only, he's like a mercenary. He immediately, when he goes to another team, the culture is instilled. So he has to leave and go to a team with better pieces, because they have mortgaged so much of their future on keeping him happy right now, so they cannot bring things to this team that would make his situation better. Or they trade Kyrie Irving. And I didn't say Kevin Love. And the reason why I didn't say Kevin Love, and not because Kevin Love I consider to be more of a valuable piece than Kyrie, is because what's going to fetch you the most dollar and the most assets on the open market? It's not Kevin Love. It's Kyrie.
So it's Kyrie, but who do you?
It's Kyrie.
So then that means you have to hope that a Kyrie can happen in a three-way trade or something, right? A three-way deal.
But or you know LeBron and what he doesn't like to do, he might have to be a little more patient and like wait till the trade deadline. And the other problem too is that because everybody knows LeBron, and this was the situation he was in last time at Cleveland. They all know he has a year on his deal. What free agent or what superstar or whoever else is going to want to come there knowing he can walk out the door and
Absolutely.
They can be left behind? So this is going to require some very fascinating maneuvering. So I'm super curious.
Does LeBron just say, hey, I'm committed to Cleveland, go ahead and do a four-year, five-year deal and then try to build it that way?
That could be something certainly that he does to try to show that, hey, I'm committed to being here to attract free agents.
Mm-hmm.
But looking at his history, I don't see him doing that. Because LeBron wants to maintain leverage at all times, and
yes.
I do not see him doing that.
That's true.
This summer is going to be very tough for Cleveland. And sometimes in the NBA, there are deals that you haven't thought of or processed, and maybe it's one of those deals out there for them that, I'm just not creative or smart enough to think of right now. But in every scenario I've tried to work out in my mind, it either involves them trading an extremely valuable piece, again, as I said, like a Kyrie, or frankly, it involves him leaving. And next summer going to say, I don't know, join the Clippers. Maybe going to or him doing like they do in the tech world all the time, you know, going to a startup, as in say the Lakers, because he already lives in LA. And so I'm just like, these are scenarios that are more possible, I think, than people think. When you look at the situation, you know, everybody's like, oh, he couldn't leave Cleveland a second time. Bullshit. Yeah, he could. And at least this time, he'll leave him with a title. And they can burn his jersey all they want, but he brought a red title. And I don't think he cares, because he's been through it twice. He doesn't care anymore about leaving teams. So I'm just really fascinated to see how this turns out.
Thoughts on Lonzo Ball. What are your thoughts on that whole situation?
I definitely am one of the people that I don't, how you raise your children is how you raise your children. And he's obviously, as much as people like to come at him, he's obviously done a good job. in the sense that he's got, you know, by all people's accounts, very polite, respectful young men who are obviously good at basketball, and he's gotten them this far. But my prediction, and this is not just about him going to the Lakers, but you're going to see a split between him and his father. Because we all know, I mean, by split, I don't mean like they're never going to talk to each other. It's going to be very negative. But in terms of their, I think their business relationship will probably end. And only from the standpoint of, I know how I was when I was young and started making my own money. Right? Gotcha. We've all been through that process. When you start making your own money and that check is written out to you, you start acting a little bit different with your parents. You just do. It's just part of growing up. And I think more quickly than we think, he will probably get his own management team. He'll probably get his own, you know, where he's going to see his own way of doing things. And he's also going to be around other young athletes who make their own money and make their own decisions, and that's going to be an influence. See, the thing is, he's staying quiet now because technically he's still in his daddy's house. Wait till he's out the house, and we'll see how his thinking changes. Like, seriously, I'm like, when he goes to the bank and that direct deposit comes into his account, it's going to be a totally different mindset. So I think LeBar, you know, there's a level of idiotic brilliance to what he's done in terms of he's built a brand for his son, even though if you even spend 2 minutes to listen to Lonzo Ball, you don't even know what Lonzo Ball sounds like because his father has been such a dominant force in their marketing campaign. So I think from that standpoint, like, it's worked. But all this crazy stuff that he's talking about, $1 billion for this and all that, like, who be fooling? Like, that's not happening. So, again, that's why I think eventually we all got that relative that had big dreams that don't make any sense. We all had that. Like, he everybody uncle at the cookout that had too much Hennessy. That's LeVar Ball.
Yeah.
So, I hate, but it's just the truth. Like, we know who he is. We all got one in our family. So, I do think his willingness to play the villain is kind of music to me. It certainly provides us, you know, good content. But I wish people would take him less seriously because there's no think piece to be done on the LeVar Ball relationship with his sons. It's just we're going to see him go through what a lot of parents do. Your kids start making their own money. He's going to eventually tell his dad to be quiet. And he's going to do his own thing. So that's kind of how I see this kind of unwinding.
Do you own a pair of Big Baller brand shoes or flip-flops?
Well, the shoes, from an aesthetic standpoint, they don't look bad at all. I just think that price point needed to be lower. And, yeah, I have no intention of buying any Big Baller brand shoes. Hey, he already said it's not for women, so, you know.
he did say that.
I don't wear slides. I saw his Big Baller brand slides. I don't wear slides anyway. So, yeah, so far I haven't seen anything that caught my eye.
Have you ever fanned out over someone responding to your tweet or someone tweeting you?
Oh, definitely. Like, the day Erykah Badu started following me, I thought I lost my whole soul. I was like, oh, my God, Erykah Badu is following me. Mike and I both do this. It's like we get way more excited about, you know, musicians, actors. We get way more excited about that than we do about, you know, athletes. It's like, yeah, that's great. But, I mean, athletes we don't even care about. I mean, you know, from the perspective of, like, fanning out. But other people outside of that, we just, you know, those are the people that appeal to me. Obviously, meeting the president was, like, a huge high point, probably the highest point in terms of meeting somebody in my career. And to have the more stunning development of that, the fact that he actually watched our show and was quite knowledgeable about it was mind-blowing. And it certainly went along the guise of you never know who's watching. And so that was a huge moment. But I just had another. The one, there are a handful of athletes I sort of hold in such high regard that it's, you know, you have to beat down my inner fangirl. But I met Serena Williams last month, and I told her to her face, I do not freak out over athletes. I don't really generally care about media, but I told her, I was just like, in my mind, we best friends. And I know that's creepy, but I'm just saying, like, this is the way it is. And she could not have been sweeter. I was like, you are phenomenal. Not because, I mean, obviously because she's an extraordinary athlete, certainly in the conversation for being the greatest athlete of our generation, regardless of gender. And
right.
But I think what she's meant to not just black people, but the black women in particular, how she's not just carried herself, but like the way in which she dominates with this fearlessness, it just ties into so many things. So,
gotcha.
So meeting her was like really very outstanding. I met Beyonce once, and I was like, see, I feel like I could float on air now. that was awesome. So, like, and then sometimes there are actors or musicians on a smaller scale that I totally don't ever, Mike and I mean, as you guys know, for people who, you know, follow us a little bit, how we feel about the Roots. And the fact that Black Thought and like Quest,
yeah, Black
and
Thought,
Breaking
yeah.
Knuckles,
mm-hmm.
and all those dudes and Chubbageddon,
right.
Like, yo, we consider them, they become like family now. And it's
dope.
I can't describe the feeling of knowing that your favorite artist is actually a friend and better people than they are musicians. And so all that is just like, wow. It's very mind blowing. I have yet to meet Jill Scott, but if I ever do, that's going to be another moment in which I, like, completely lose my mind. those moments, one of the sort of side benefits to doing what we do is that it's been possible for us to have some experiences that neither one of us ever could have imagined happening and putting us in some circles we didn't even think we'd ever be in.
We didn't get a chance to talk about you playing Bones with Ice Cube, man, that classic. We didn't get a chance to talk about that. I am curious, though. I know your mom voted for President Trump, and we don't have to go into the whole background about that, but what is her, now that he's been the president for over 100 days?
Yeah, how's she feeling about that now? you know, I don't know. I haven't asked her, because once she told me that, and I had a suspicion she did. And look, it is, people are very stunned when they've asked, like, I don't understand. And I was like, it actually, in a way, it gave me a very good, it gave me a real, really good insight into how he got elected to begin with.
Absolutely.
No, it did, and I understood it. And we tended, obviously, a lot of it has been pinned on the undercurrent of racism in this country, all true. But the other part that we, I think, kind of underrated, and I saw this in my own mother, is that when you get older, and my mother's only 60 years old, when you get older, there's so many more things that frighten you. And he was speaking her language because of the things she's frightened of now that are, this is where media is at fault, and this is where technology has its downside, is it's convinced people that the world has always been dangerous, but sometimes too much information is a bad thing, in the sense that we've created an environment of fear into how we process things, that have people that are like my mother's age thinking that terrorism is around every corner, and that, yes, you know, locking up our borders and shutting things down, and I'm not just saying this related to Mexico, but just in general, that idea seems very sane to them, okay? And they don't understand that it's awful and horrible, as we're reading about, like, what happened in London and all these things that we see that happen in the world, people process them so much differently now. So much differently, like, where it really has people on edge. So when you have somebody that comes along and says, I'm shutting down our borders. We're not letting anybody in there. That seems rational. Because they're right. Like, oh, no, I don't want what happened in London to happen here. I don't want another 9/11. And I get it. I get it. Right. And so that was the part, more than anything, that spoke to her. And it says President Obama was a different kind of president because he was one of the most progressive presidents we've ever had. And he had a calming and open spirit about him. And unfortunately, there were people that processed that as weakness. And mm-hmm. I don't get it, but I've grown up in a different thought process. I read a lot. I understand that the world is much more about diplomacy than strength. But we have mm-hmm. people here that feel like it should be strength. And my mother grew up in a time where America had to flex on people all the mm-hmm. time. And she's used to, accustomed to that kind of governing style. So the things that Donald mm-hmm. Trump said to her really honestly appealed to her.
I think that what also was missed from the media perspective was they all lived in this bubble that didn't connect with folks like your mother or folks in those Detroit, in those blue-collar workers. They didn't have a pulse on what those guys were thinking. And I think you hit the nail on the head with even some of the thoughts that your mom had. But I was curious with her thoughts now that he was in office.
She's obviously somebody who lived through Nixon, so you know, all the scandal. I don't know how she's processed it now, because it's on a lot of levels, it's not good for us for our relationship to discuss politics.
I get it.
I legitimately have not had a discussion with her about that since she told me she voted for him. And she's one of those, like you said, dependent. I mean, everybody, I think, feels this way in general. But when you grow up in Michigan and some of these pockets, you have this mentality, understandably so, of like America first and all this other stuff. So if all you're hearing is the catchphrases, like it sounds real good. Like, yeah, I'm going to put Americans first, and this and that, and, you know, all the stuff that during his campaign he was saying about, like, you know, factory workers and you're forgotten and I'm going to think about you. Problem is, probably Hillary Clinton's fault in her campaign is she kept it a little too real. And what a lot of these people who live in, working class kind of towns and built around industries and factories, what they don't get is that it's not an outsider that's your enemy. Your enemy is robotics. Your enemy is technology. And they don't get that. It's like, yo, it's the reason why these jobs ain't coming back. If they could, look, it's almost self-driving cars, right? That's your enemy. Your enemy is the fact that they can build a robot to put together a car way cheaper than you. Don't have to care about your benefits. That's your enemy. It's not some imaginary outsider that they've created, that's some undocumented illegal person that they created in your mind and mythology that's going to come in and take your job. It's going to be a robot. That's who's taking your job. So, unfortunately, those things play well to a certain generation, and she's reflective of that generation where she grew up, where America made things, and we don't make things anymore. We make pop culture. Right. We make records. We make movies. That's what we do now. You know, we don't make widgets.
Right.
We just don't.
Right.
And it's been harder for people to process that. So I think for people like her, that they felt left out of the conversation, and they felt like, you know, folks like me and you would keep telling them how wrong they are on a daily basis and how the world didn't work that way. And they got sick of that. They got sick of that shit. They just did. Like, I'm tired of being told I'm wrong all the time, that how I think doesn't work anymore. And they voted for him. And I get it. I don't like it, but I get it. It just is what it is.
Speaking of cars, we got to talk about the Maserati. How the Maserati doing? And what are you, when you're decompressing, you're riding, you're letting your hair down, what are you listening to in the Maserati?
I got a few playlists. For a while, and it was perfect timing, because kind of not too long after I got it, that new Rick Ross came out, and I was banging that for a minute.
Okay.
That was strong. They got some strong play up in the ride, for sure.
Okay.
And, it is. Every time I drive that car, I can't believe I actually it's mine. I'm just like, wow, I really did this. I went out and bought myself something so horribly obnoxious. It's just a testament to, you know, everything I've been through, a testament to what God has brought me through. And so I indulge. And in fact, so much to the point. I just got some new summer shoes, you know, and I got winter shoes, I got summer shoes, and while you're playing, I might get fall ones. So, when people ask me about the car, I said, trust me, you'll hear me before you see me, because the engine's just that loud. You will hear me. It sounds like a race car. So, Mike and I was joking with him when we were at game three, and we had to go through the player's entrance, just based on how we, sort of came in the building and quickened. And I was like, I'm looking at these cars. You know, the crazy part is, our cars could be parked in here and no one would know the difference. Right. No one would know that it didn't belong to a player. I was like, that's right. How good. That's what God has brought us to. So, and we cracked up and laughed about it.
Well, Jemele, we really appreciate your time and your willingness to be on the show. And
thank you so much. And we really appreciate you guys' support. It really is very humbling, and it's very kind and generous of you.
We appreciate you all. Before you get out of here, you know, just let the people know how they can connect to you with, you know, through social media, so the people will know where to find you.
All right. Well, the 6 o'clock Sports Center on Monday through Friday, which me and Mike co-host on 6 o'clock Eastern, I should say, and that's where we are most nights. And I crack up just because if we miss a day on the show, people assume we got fired. I'm like, why does it have to be so dastardly? Like, why is it that if I miss a day, like, I got fired or they cancel the show? Sometimes we have vacation days. It happens.
Right.
So, yes, you can find us there on Instagram, Snapchat, Twitter, Facebook. I'm all under the same name, Jemele Hill. Not very creative, but that's what it is. And, yeah, that's pretty much it. And, you know, I love connecting and reaching out to people and everything. So, just hit me up. And it's been great to certainly connect with you guys. And then anytime we can help you guys out, let us know.
Indeed.
Absolutely. So, thank you, man. Yeah, red talk, 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 red talk